Welcome to the TriUnity Series. I'm Randy Maugans from offplanetradio.com, and as always, we have with us our presenter, author, and scholar, Dr. Shmuel Asher is with us. And today we're going to kind of go into what may be considered to be a bit of speculation, but it's based on assessments that are themselves based on the volume of work that Dr. Asher has done and even my own research into what is going on with data aggregation, collection, virtual reality, AI constructs, and the looming colossus of digitization of pretty much the entire landscape of human reality. With that intro, we'll just kind of launch into it. Shmuel, welcome.
I'm glad to be back. This is, what, show six?
And, yes.
You might want to tell everybody that we tried to do show six already a couple of times and got hammered from a communications point of view.
Yeah, the AI was quite active over the Tammuz celestial holiday that people celebrate around the world called Christmas. So we tried to do some work, and we just got hammered mercilessly. Things that just couldn't even possibly happened.
Yeah, I never saw. I really never experienced civilian communications being hammered so hard for seemingly no reason. The strangest stuff. But
The Skype line here literally went into a loop when we tried to reestablish contact, because we record these shows with Dr. Asher on a landline. And we're using Skype on our end because that's the easiest way to get a recording. So what happened was we had a decaying audio signal throughout the entire call that just got increasingly more bizarre as we went on. And then finally, Shmuel, actually, I think you tried to call back in on the inbound number and discovered, oh, I called you back. And all that happened was a loop of the last utterance that I had made in the Skype. After, 5-10 minutes, we continued to just loop back and forth. It was still capturing that loop. Unbelievable.
Yeah, I have to say that was very strange, because we were talking, and then all of a sudden you said a word, I can't remember what it was, and it took it was a longer 3-4-syllable word, and it took to about the halfway point of the word, started looping the word over and over and over and over and over, just like that. And that's what I kept hearing. And then I hung up, and then you called back on another phone, I think, and we were talking. And then about a half hour later, you tried to Skype again. And as soon as you called me with the Skype, as soon as I picked up, that loop from a half hour earlier was still continuing. And I just do not have a clue of how that could be possible if you shut off the Skype. And I remember you said you shut it off. Shut everything down.
We cleared everything. I literally rebooted a router, moved to another part of the house, reconfigured the entire setup. Now, in that time, the way Skype works, IP addresses are constantly switching when you're using Skype. It hands off signals, and it's constantly intelligently, so-called, attempting to route calls to the most efficient IP routers on the Internet. I mean, that's the fundamental way that the Internet works. In this case, it appears as though the router itself was frozen somehow. Now, most of this is theoretically impossible. And that frozen loop of spoken word continued to reverberate across the Skype connection between my Skype connection and your landline phone. And I have to say, I understand network topology. I've worked around networks and IP addresses and routers for 20 years, and I still can't explain any of this.
No, it makes no sense, because if you cut it all off, you shut the power down and everything, and then a half hour later, you made the call back. Ostensibly, it would have went through other routers.
Exactly, yes. Yeah.
It would have redirected in a completely different down a different path to get to me, but then somehow found the exact same path, keeping the exact same looping insanity. It was amazing. I got to say, it was amazing.
So that kind of brings us back to what our original conversation was going to be, Shmuel, because you and I have talked at length in private about what's really going on with all this data aggregation. And it's pretty dark and it's pretty ominous. For people that don't understand, we're building here as we've gone through this series. We've built on a number of logical sequences that are based on the concept that we are basically in a matrix system that was hijacked. Not only does that hijacking occur in real time, but it is occurring outside of time, astrally, or however you want to term that, in terms of our souls being, you know, constantly looped back through a reincarnation cycle, memory wipe, and then dropped back in, as it were, into another timeline, another lifeline. So construct's quite elaborate. It's very difficult for people who are tied up in either the scientific, technological sphere of things, and also in the religious sphere as well, because they don't really have a working fundamental understanding of what we think is really going on.
Right, and like I said, you know, where I was trying to pick up last time we tried this, from the show before, the fifth show, was recapping basically on how, you know, all of us alive right now have been reborn, you know, many times, and it's also ostensibly always for the purpose of helping humanity, right? Which is what all the majority of these near-death experience people come back with, and also what the past life regression people come back with. And that's obviously we've been doing an abysmal job of helping humanity, if that's what this is all about. So the great majority of the souls, you know, through all generations, have retained no groundbreaking memories to that end. So we can see that, you know, when I saw through all, well, through a lifetime, and now which has culminated in this particular book, was that this whole narrative system, you know, appears to be like a guilt latent. When you go up there to their false heaven matrix, it's a guilt laden process. It's basically created to soften up the soul's groundwork, or, you know, laying the groundwork for what else is to come, for them to consent to the next step, which is a manner of different things. The soul school classes, like we were talking about, that allegedly give specific knowledge that no one remembers, or we don't think they remember. I've had other thoughts about that ever since I wrote the book, but either way, we're being forced to return, and return with no memory, which then in the book, you remember, I go into the different types that I line out as different types. Your type of the NDEs or the past life regression stuff, after looking at it all, I thought it broke down to like 2 to 3 different types, categories, you know. So I have type 1A, type 1B, type 2, and sort of type 1A, just to recap that real quick, I think those are, you know, those are the type 1A are like the majority. That's the great majority of information that comes back, whether it's NDEs or past life regression. The information that comes back is all very, very highly consistent, actually, and it seems to me that's the great majority of who comes back. And I personally believe that is the type 1 accounts that we hear most of, whether they're NDEs or past life regressions, which I call PLR. I think those are a direct product of the Archon false heaven system. And then we have the type 1Bs, which are a variation on the type 1A. And, you know, in most cases, they just don't appear to exhibit the same heavenly attributes as experienced by the majority of the type 1A experiencers. The variation that I can see is that the type 1Bs, they experience like kind of like a high level of past life and death memory recall. So they're coming back. Those are the many usually children who come back and say, well, they remember their last life and they remember all these details, and that's where my type 1B comes in. People that are usually children coming back and remembering a high amount of detail of their past life. Nothing, you know, nothing overly helpful to humanity. I mean, no one's coming back and telling us how the pyramids were built or anything. So, it's just that kind of stuff. So that would be the type 1Bs, just a high level of, and for a short time, it seems like they also tend to forget it maybe after a while, but they're on like the type 1As. And then you have the type 2s, which I think are the far simpler, have an experience, which are the what I consider to be the real experience, where the people are truly going back to the original creator for some reason. And I haven't yet been able to nail down why certain people do go back to that original creator. But the type 2s are built on dissimilarities, right? We went through that before, the type 2s. And I think in the book I used a few of them. I used a few type 1s. One of them was the Israeli kid. Actually, two Israeli people that are well documented, but the newest one was in 2015, I believe. He was 15, 16 years old, and he was definitely a type one. And I used his transcript of his explanation of the whole thing in detail that was done in the yeshiva, or I guess the synagogue, with his rabbi in front of everyone, and he had him lay it all out in detail. And so I used the transcript of that in the book because, or part of the transcript of that in the book, because it really did show that type one. It really does prove that type one of how it's a narrative set up based on what they're pulling out of your soul, based on what you've assimilated to that point, is what they're using to blow back on you. So the type twos are far simpler than that. The type twos, the original one, I believe, and it's really a lack of attributes that the type ones have, I can go through that list real quick. It's just basically the type two experiences have a lack of the type one attributes. So that lack would be, you know, no experience of being pulled into a tunnel with light. They have no past life review process. They have no soul school classes, no soul guides, no council of elders or judgment sessions. No contradicting promises made, like you can stay here forever, but now you got to go. No guilt trip prodding, which I seem to find in all those past life regression people. They have that real guilt trip thing happening where they use the information gathered from the, past life review to prod you to go help other people. So, and then I think what was most telling is that those type 2s that go directly back to the creator, they don't seem to have any localized experience like everyone else. And I think that comes out later while we'll talk about what we're ultimately getting into here after I do this recap, is all this NSA stuff and whatever. And there's a reason for it, because the localized experience is what people are coming back with. You know, oh, I left my body, I was hovering above, I saw the doctors, I saw this, I saw that, right? So people like really well-documented stuff like Dr. Evan Alexander, my friend Michelle, who I also used in the book, and others, don't have that localized experience. They show up. They're there with the creator. And that's basically where it starts for them, and a total lack of all that other Hollywood that comes with that. So the type twos, I believe, are the real re-entry into your original existence, and that, you know, I think, like I said, Evan Alexander is a good place for people if they haven't looked at his story, because I found the same, and it's amazing, because I found the same thing with him to be with my friend Michelle and others. When they went back, the two things, they have a lack of all the other attributes that everyone else has, which is the majority, and so they have a lack of all those things. But I find most interesting is that what they're told, A, they remember. See, that's the key, and that's the key I tell people to really look for in the book Soul Revolution, is, and I think it's a key that's pretty difficult to argue against, is the lack of memory. That is the absolute key or proof that we're on to something with this, because if it really was a creator system, if it really was created for our betterment, the removal of memory, that's insanity. That goes against everything that could possibly be positive that comes out of it. And when these people go back, like Dr. Alexander, not only do they have the lack of all these other attributes that the majority have when they go back to that false heaven matrix, but Alexander, when he came back and Michelle came back, they remembered, and others, there's others out there you can read, and they have the same thing. When they come back, they remember what they were told, and what, like Alexander was told, Dr. Alexander was told, you know, the quote was that he says that our entire reason for being is love and mercy. And, you know, if you think about that, if that was provided to every soul that died and came back, that one simple phrase, that would be, it would work like some never-ending booster shot for the betterment of this creation, you know, that if everyone came back with that and lived that after they were, if they were so, you know, overtaken by it and driven by it and lived that from then on, this place would be different overnight. So obviously, you know, that's not happening with everyone else. They're not having that memory. They're not being told that. And it's not allowing for a really sustainable, positive existence. And that's one thing that's, I think, of excruciating importance here is, like, when you look at Alexander's and the other ones I put in the book, some type 1s, some type 2s. The type 2s, what I think of is excruciatingly important is that when he went back and she went back and others have gone back to the true creator, their version of near-death experience doesn't, you know, or after-death experience, isn't reliant on what they assimilated in life. And that's like one of the biggest keys. Besides the memory loss of everyone else, which is like the ultimate key, the ultimate proof, the fact that these people are coming back with what they remember, and what they remember is basically the essence of the entire everlasting agreement. Love and mercy, period. You know, and so in other words, what I'm saying is that their experience was not reliant on their soul's previously learned and believed false narratives. False narratives weren't pulled out of them to create what they needed them to see or experience. They just got there, and they got the message. It was very, very clear and simple. So, like, to put a finer point on it, it's become clear to me, anyway, that the worldly narrative streams are preset for all the souls, people here, to choose and assimilate as their personal truths. You know, through any lifetime, they're supplied for the sole purpose of being extracted from the soul's consciousness after death. So, so it's basically what I call in the book the narrative extraction process, which affords the Archon system. It gives them the ability, the mechanism, to extract soul-specific data required to tailor-make each experience. And if you look at really all the one type ones that I put in the book, especially the two Israeli kids, or no, one's a Druid kid, one's an Israeli kid, those two really show you very clearly that these are specific things that have been designed so that you have a specific experience and come back with a specific experience, but no actual memories of anything. So, like I said, I pushed pretty hard on, I don't know, it was the fourth or fifth show, that all of this should ultimately teach us to start discarding the old false narrative paths, you know, that we've believed, that we've assimilated, you know, and start assimilating a new one, just like was told to Alexander and Michelle and others, based on love and mercy. In my first books, I taught that exact same thing. I said that the everlasting agreement is purely based on love, mercy, and equity. But technically, the message that Michelle and Alexander Eben and others have gotten, that your entire reason for being is love and mercy, is actually more correct than how I've taught it, because I've taught it like that we should all be projecting love, mercy, and equity, and that's how I constantly taught it. But technically, when I looked at this, I thought, you know, this is, the Creator obviously is more right than I am, because he says just love and mercy, and I understood that as, when I saw it that way, by understanding that if you project only love and mercy, then what comes out of it is equity, that equity is not a separate entity, a separate thing unto itself, so, which is not overly important for our discussion here, but I just thought I'd make that. So basically, you know, what I'm saying is also a lot of this has to do with other false narratives that have come up out of it. We look at, like, as we segue into the next, what this was supposed to be about, this show. A lot of what we see that comes out of this stuff as well is this whole return of the gods thing from forever, all the way back from the alleged Sumerian tablets, you know, all the way to every place on the earth, every rock, every ever scribbled on, talks about every text, the return of the gods, return of the gods, and you know, all this. I think it all segues together in the end, and I think this whole NSA thing, but before I get into that, I wanted to just hit on one thing that I had thought of after I wrote the book about those soul school classes, and I think this is probably an important point for everyone. Well,
you know, one of the problems with this whole thesis of the memory wipe and drop back into incarnational cycles is, it came up on a show that Emily Moyer and I did towards the end of the year with an author named Walter Bosley. And Walter is both a former FBI agent in charge of security, and he is a commissioned officer in the United States Air Force. He writes some paranormal-type material, and he's actually a good author and a pretty interesting guy to talk to. But the subject of this mind wipe reincarnation thing came up in the course of the conversation, and his response to it, after we got off the air, I said, Emily, I wish I'd had the presence of mind to say what I was thinking at the time, but sometimes I don't contradict guests in the course of an interview. But it was largely this. His response to that was, well, I think this occurs so that we can focus on this lifetime. Now, by analogy, what I wanted to say and what I should have said was, well, if that's true, then let's take take soldiers that have just gone through boot camp and drop them into the cockpit of a military jet and let them fly the damn thing. Because that's what you're talking about, basically. You're talking about us coming in here theoretically to, quote, make a better world, to do good, to help humanity. But each time we come in, we're basically stripped of all of the knowledge that we would have had from previously accumulated lifetimes. In some cases, I think we're worse off. I mean, you know, if you believe the law of karma, which I think is their law, it's not Creator's law, we are basically hobbled coming in relative to even previous incarnation experiences. So you're basically talking about handicapping someone while giving them a mission statement to help humanity. That's patently absurd. It's not logical on any level.
No, not on any level. And that just comes from a lack of in-depth surveillance of this whole thing, you know, for a lifetime, and also, you know, in really pointedly researching it. There's no way that can be true. And like I say, I go through it in that book for that point, to show that, you know, there could be two sides of it, but it really does, the vast majority of the information lends itself to it being a usurped system that is has enslaved its occupants by their own consent. And I think most of that is very provable by what we have on hand. And to think that the lack of memory at all does not extend, if we're supposed to be this Trinity 6 physical being, if that's what we're really supposed to be like, most Christians believe we are, then not allowing any information to consistently return is doing nothing. It's even worse than hobbling, at least, because when you're hobbled, you know, when a horse is hobbled, he knows he's hobbled.
That's true, yeah.
He at least knows he's conscious of it. The people in this planet for the longest time have not been conscious that they're even hobbled. They're not even conscious of the fact that they're not conscious of the fact. It's beyond. I can't.
Well, you
really
don't know what you don't know. That's the problem.
And I hate that expression. It's so basic. I feel like I need more to express it and expand on that. But I don't have the words for it.
Well, and the other side of it is, which goes into more the long-term thrust of what your work is and why you're doing it, is that not only were our memories wiped, but history has been so concisely rewritten that any wisdom given from on high, any inspired words of Creator, any utterances of the prophets that were legitimately planted there for humanity, with a few rare exceptions, have been rewritten, redacted, edited, wiped out, or reconciled to the scrap heap of so-called accepted, in the case of Judeo-Christianity, have been relegated to basically forbidden books. And that's true with all religions. It's true with Islam. It's true with Buddhism. It's true even with the writings of Laozi and the ancient wisdom of the East. We're left with shreds of paper. It's like, okay, so I don't have a book. Give me a damn fortune cookie. And you pull out a shred of paper from a fortune cookie, and that's what you have to work with. That's the state of humanity in terms of transmitted wisdom down through the ages right now.
Right, because of the law of free will, which exists, and which I go into in pretty good depth in this book, which has been rewritten, as you say, and re-understood as something else, as in the beginning God created the gland and whatever, okay? The thing is, because of the law of free will, these entities are not allowed. They know it. They cannot remove all the information. And you know, you can prove this, because as above, so below, you can prove this once you start looking into how governments and laws work here.
Mm-hmm.
You can prove it by the fact that you're a slave. Now, there's thousands of these, okay? But one big one that many people have looked into, even myself, is that you're born into this system of slavery. You're given a number, all right, the tax number. And they take your birth certificate, and on the back of your birth certificate is a Class A stock number starting with an A, and they use that as in a way to actually create wealth out of nowhere, based on your ability to work for a certain amount of years in their system, and you are stuck paying taxes because it's the law and this and that. But what you don't know is that they also, at the same time, have created a legal way, legal, not lawful, but legal way in their system that runs parallel with that. And it's not up to them. See, the law of free will doesn't force them to market this information openly.
No.
It doesn't force them to actively teach you and make you aware of said information. That's up to you. And if you're a dumb cow, and you go through your life working your little job and not paying attention to anything else for 70, 80 years, and then they wear you out and you die and they put you in the ground, recycle your useless ass back into the system again for the same exact thing, and you will do the same exact thing because you've learned nothing, and your soul has imprinted nothing of any use on any other trips in and out of this place. So, but they are, they're subject to creating a way out, is my point. So there is a way out. So you can get out of this tax slave system. It's pretty simple, actually. And there's papers involved.
Mm-hmm.
There's things involved that you have to give up information, this and that. You have to send it to this place. They have to send it back to you. And then you have to send the next set of information. And then they send it back to you. And it happens to be in Puerto Rico. Why? Because Puerto Rico is where the
IRS is.
Where the main IRS
yeah.
is. And why? Because the IRS is an unconstitutional, illegal entity.
No, it's a collection agency domiciled in Puerto Rico as a corporation.
Yes, it's domiciled in Puerto Rico because it can't even lawfully work inside the United States. So that's why. But you can do this. So that does exist. And it's not only that. People think they need driver's license. You don't need a driver's license.
No.
Someone told me that a long time. I didn't believe it. I researched the hell out of it. And I found, even through the federal laws, and not only that, through the federal courts have even upheld this. I have at least four accounts that the federal laws have upheld this, that no one needs a driver's license to travel under any reason.
No.
Not even if you own your own business. It's not considered commerce, traveling through commerce. It's pretty amazing. And it's right out there in black and white. Now, do the cops know this? No. So if you drive around with no license, of course you're going to get hammered in their system, unless you know how to not get hammered in your system, which is a whole another lifetime worth of learning, which a lot of people are doing, and I don't have time to do. But this is what I'm saying is that the law of free will, even you can prove it by looking at how they work here. You'll see that for every system that they make it appear is mandatory, it's not actually mandatory. They give it the appearance of a mandatory thing, a mandatory tax, a mandatory license, a mandatory you have to get a permit to build something on the back of your house, and this and that. They give it the appearance of being mandatory. It's not mandatory. They just give it that appearance because the stupid cows.
Yeah, it's called color of law. It's basically appearance of legality. Well, people forget that legality simply means being able to do something that's otherwise against the law of God. Legal is not lawful.
Right.
The two terms are mutually exclusive of each other.
Exactly. And words are magic because that's what they've done. They've used the English language, especially
spellcraft.
Right, because you can't do this in Hebrew, by the way. You can't do what they do with the English in Hebrew. You can't use that Hebrew language in that magic, in that way, like you can the English.
Well,
that's why the English
And going back to that, by the way, it's long been considered by people that have studied etymology that the English language was a purpose-made language that was begun back in around the 1300s. If you go back and compare the English language of Chaucer to the English mm-hmm. language, even later, of Shakespeare, the King James Bible, and the transmission of the English language forward, it appears as though English itself was created as a language to become some sort of international spellcraft. In other words, for the construction of language. Latin lent itself to that, but was a very difficult language to transmit. English is a purpose-made language that is now pretty much universal. Everybody speaks English. I mean, you know, somebody said, well, if the Nazis had won World War II, we'd be speaking German today. And I'm like, no, they won, but everybody else learned to speak English. They understood that. So we're that far down the line.
Yeah, and there's a lot of people out there that I've seen, pretty amazingly, will show you even through Black's Law Dictionary, how we look at certain words, very basic words, and we think that this word means, you know, like the word may, M-A-Y, right? So we think if a law has the word may in it, see, by their understanding, may means will. See, to us, you know, it'll say, you know, that blah, 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 may happen to you, okay? Well, that's not what it means. Of course, six other words in that sentence also are not what we think they mean. So that particular word, I remember somebody showed me that it actually, in their law language, means will, not may happen. It will happen. And these are different things. So it's that, and on top of it, so their legalese is a whole other, like, magician's language, and with that. So there's a lot of people, if you could look up online and whatnot, that are really, really delved into that and show you what all the words mean and how they're all crafted together and how certain phrases actually don't mean what you think they mean. It's quite disturbing, actually, when you get into a lot of that. And, you know, I could see where a lot of people would be on a roof with a rifle in no time if they really started delving into that stuff, because it starts painting a picture that you are so beyond helpless that, you know, the instinct of most people is violence after that, you know, which is probably what they're hoping for anyway. But what I was getting at with the Soul School classes is the last point I want to make on that before we go into that whole NSA thing was, and I didn't put this in a book, and maybe I will, maybe I'll go back and have it added, but, you know, I say in the book, and I, well, from what the past life regression people say, is that they have no recollection of what they learn in these soul school classes. So at first, you know, you don't know what to really make of that. And then it hit me. I thought, what if, because, you know, how it works in my mind, in my head, how my head works, is it's like I'm standing in the middle of a rotunda, okay, a giant round room. And everything I've ever learned, everything I know, is on single pieces of paper. And they're all the way around a room from floor to roof to ceiling. And I can stand there. My brain is I'm standing in a room full of post-its, and that's how I see it. And I could stand there, and as an idea comes out of the ether, wherever it comes from, down through the ceiling, and I think about it, and this is how I've always told people they have to get to this point in their learning. They can't just read the Bible. They can't just learn a little bit here, a little bit there, forget 20% of what they learned over here and over there. You really do have to spend so many years learning every single day for most of the day, like a weightlifter, a professional weightlifter, does his work, so do you have to do yours. Because what that gains you in the end is that you're able to stand in that rotunda, and when a question comes in or an idea comes in, excuse me, you are able to instantly, somehow, and I don't know how this works, but I'm instantly able to pull from everything I've ever learned off those walls, little single pieces inside of sections, and pull them all together, and it gives me the best possible outcome of what's possible based on everything there is to know, if you've spent that much time compiling the information in your head. So that's, you know, if people need a picture of what's going on in my head, that's what it is. And so as I thought about these soul school classes, I thought, you know, no memory, that doesn't, you know, how does that work? Because I'm standing there and I'm thinking, wait a minute, I have to remember everything. I can't just look at this. What is this? What are we in? What is this for? It's a usurped creation that's been usurped. It's been filled with false narratives that we assimilate, all negative, for one end, so that our emotions are created, and our souls project that constantly. So we're taking in negativity in various levels and various ways. Some of it we don't even perceive as negative because we've been we have so much scar tissue, most people, they don't see it as negative. Then we have the meat-eating process, which physically changes our physicality to a point that it creates, I'm calling it a firewall, or you can say it dumbs you down even further spiritually. It's proven scientifically to do that, so I don't even have to convince anyone of that anymore if they go looking for it. And I do mention it in my books, but so we have all these things coalescing together, and it all comes out to building a system that pushes us through it, forces us to assimilate what it has given us to assimilate, all right? And it's always adding to those narratives, changing them a little bit as the times go. Like you can see, we've moved from prophecy eras to religious eras, highly religious eras, to not-so-religious eras like now, where people are quasi-religious and not, you know, and then we get into more accepting, and we move into an enlightenment phase, I think, which then we generally get hammered into another epoch where all of it starts over. So, but we have to remember what this is, what it's for, what's being done in it, everything that's being done in it, where it's all coming from, which directions it's coming from. There's a lot of stuff to remember all at one time, but you have to do it, because if you don't remember it all at one time, you're going to miss a lot, and you're going to give wrong information to people, or people's arguments are going to be able to overcome yours, because you don't have everything on the tip of your tongue. So that's how I was taught. To make sure that I've learned everything I can possibly learn as far back as it will possibly go so that no one can overcome my argument. And no one has. So this is what my grandfather taught me. So basically what we're looking at is, what are these soul school classes? Why would they put a soul through something like this that they're all remembering they actually go to, but they're not remembering what they learned? Well, then I thought, maybe I'm slightly wrong about this. Maybe we are remembering what we learned. It's just another infiltration of a narrative on a much more sublime level. Like, maybe the past life regression scientists are only able to go back so far. More than likely, there's a wall there, another firewall. And what's beyond that wall is what we learned in these soul school classes. It's stuck in our soul, but they can't get to it by the means they have now. However, through life, through physical life, that information is, which has been pre-programmed in these alleged soul school classes, which we have no memory of, no conscious memory of, at some deeper subconscious point, all right, that stuff exists. So what I started thinking was that we know through thousands of past life regressions that these soul school classes obviously exist for some reason. So, I mean, the probability map there of how many tell this story is, in my mind, you know, it's far beyond, you know, just chance, happenstance. So we know that exists. But why does it exist? Well, now, again, go back to thinking. Stand in the middle of that room, pull all the information, and think about, what is this place for? What is it all designed to do? What path is it taking? Everyone's walking the same direction. Everyone's being assimilated in pretty much the same crap. What would those soul school classes be? So I thought, well, if it's subconscious, deeply subconscious, I'm just going to posit that the souls are being programmed at that point with all the negative phobias, from minor phobias to horrific phobias that people have in life, to minor mental issues, to massively horrific mental issues that people have in life, from minor mental issues and phobias that people don't really want to step over a crack in a sidewalk to Jeffrey Dahmer, okay? You know, so it runs the gamut, and that is probably where that stuff is stored. And they come out, and I do hit on this in the book, so I you know, it's just, it eludes me how this eluded me when I was writing the book. But I did kind of touch on this in the book, where I showed in the last chapter, which is probably the most important chapter of the book, and actually most people don't know it, but it's the first chapter that I wrote for that book. It just wound up being the last chapter, because it makes more sense there. But that particular chapter goes into this to some degree, that and it hammers the psychological medical community, which I don't even think should be a medical community, pretty hard, because they don't fix anyone, they drug everyone, they've and by their own admittance, most times they cannot find the source for why Jeffrey Dahmer's Jeffrey Dahmer, why you know, a serial pedophile is a serial pedophile. Where does that come from? And they can't find anything in the physical past. The father wasn't a pedophile. You know, and sometimes, there, of course, there is that stuff. But generally, a lot of times, if there is, if a girl's raped from her stepfather or something from an early age, most of the time it goes the other way. That girl doesn't become a pedophile. It usually goes the other way. So a lot of these doctors can't figure out the origination points of all these phobias and medical issues, or what they deem as medical issues, which are not medical issues at all. They're soul issues, and that's what the whole book's about, technically. But I get into it mostly in the last chapter. My point here is that maybe that's what these soul school classes are. They are a place where they can hide, deeply hide in the some depth of the soul, some horrific crap that is slowly dripped out like an IV over time through a person's life. Sometimes the drip is faster, sometimes the drip is slower. That gets you your different variances between your minor phobias up to your complete psychosis. And there you have it. That's probably what those are. That's probably what those soul classes are. They're not for the betterment of anything, because what it is, it's kind of like a built-in narrative. All the other narratives we assimilate, all right? They're out there. They've been out there forever. They run the gamut from political to religious to whatever, all right? And they're out there for everybody to assimilate, okay? And some assimilate more than others, and it's cultural and the whole thing. Okay, so it's, but they're out there. You can choose not to assimilate those, but if they have the ability to do what I'm positing here, and until somebody else comes up with some good information of what these soul school classes actually are, I'm going to stick with this, because this makes sense to me. This is the place where no one can find. This is where the doctors go and say, well, we don't know where the origination point of why this person is such a complete nut, or why does he can't step on cracks, or why does he think that this and that and the other thing is, you know, after him all the time, or whatever. They can't find it. They can't work their way back, not even with past life regression, not even with any kind of regression of any kind that the doctors are now using more and more, can they get to these people's problem, because they're hidden behind another wall that they probably can't get through. And so that's where I think that's coming from. And if that's the case, you know, see, it's just another, that would be more of a built-in narrative, like another reason why the last chapter of my book is so important, I think, and why I wrote it, was because a very dear loved one of mine, you know, many years ago, I mean, I knew it from when she was a child, and so did my other sister know that when she was a child, that this person was a lesbian. Now, that is a title. That's a label I personally don't like, because and it's another point that I didn't really, I brought it up in the book in different ways, but I have since then found a good label for it, and it's another narrative that is built in beforehand. It's built in before the person's born, just like the soul school class phobias and mental illnesses or whatever is being jammed in there can easily be put in there before the person returns, the soul returns, and comes out later. So we have what I'm now calling regendered souls. And this is highly important because it's something that we can look through time, from ancient times till now, and see that it's actually been stepped up. The program's been, the soul regendering program has been stepped up. What I mean is that souls are not male or female, they're both. They're a perfect soul, or just like a perfect soul inside a human body, would be the perfect yin and yang, the perfect balance of male and female. Okay? The Lara Croft. Highly physically toned female. Great fighter. Able to protect and able to defend. But, at the same time, able to nurture in equal parts. That's perfect. That's the perfect soul. With perfect equal parts. Not male, not female, both. But, as I've said in the book, the soul has its own, what I call, it's not genetic, but it's just a good way to say it. The soul takes on memory, which the Russian scientists have now proven, takes on memory through our DNA. So it takes on memory, then leaves with it, and keeps it forever. So in the book, I go into how you have the gay people, right? What we call gay people. These are regendered souls. They're not gay people. They're not gay males, lesbian females. That's not what they are. They're regendered souls. And this is a very important topic because it's so divisive in this world.
Yeah, this is this is the thing that we can't talk about, especially
right.
About what we're going to talk about.
Right, and it's a highly divisive narrative. But if you were them, you were the archons, and your goal, remember, is to drop in narratives that are going to be progressively more agitating. Well, this is a good one. They must have been laughing their asses off when they came up with this one.
Yeah.
You know? Let's regender the souls. We have all these souls here that we have put in female physical bodies for so long that the soul itself has absorbed the female attributes of the human physicality more than they have male. Now let's take them and drop them into a male body and see what happens. You know, it's kind of like when you take the stick off the bottle rocket and light it. It doesn't follow a straight path anymore. No pun intended. It just flies, you know, all over the place. It's emotionally disrupted for its lifetime. And then on the other side, you have the idiots, the religious morons in this planet, who used to stone them to death, now have decided that the archons have decided through their narratives to say, well, we have scientifically proven that these people are born this way. They're born this way, which, you know, on the face, all right, seems benevolent. It seems benevolent. You know, we say, you know, they're born this way. It's not a big deal. Leave them alone. We don't want to stone them anymore. Let's treat them equally. Let's give them rights. Let's da 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 da. Because why? Because they're born this way. And by saying we have scientifically proven, which is complete and utter bullshit, they have not scientifically proven that. It is proven that they have not scientifically proven that. Even in their own ridiculous words, when they try to say they've proven it, you can read it and see that they're trying to get that point across, but they're not giving any proof, and they're just for the dumbed down population, when they read these white papers or read these articles from these alleged scientists and doctors, they will come across like they've proven it. But see, the same way no one asks which God, the same way no one asks how come in school they taught me that radiation lasts for 1,000 years once it's unleashed, but, you know, a year after Nagasaki and Hiroshima, the plants started growing.
Yeah, exactly.
And cities grew up out of them, and everybody's fine. You know? I mean, the level of stupidity here with humanity is literally epic. But, again, my people perish for their lack of understanding. That no prophet could have been more on point than that one, than Hoshea. So what we have here is this regendered system telling people that they are born this way, which, like I said, seems benevolent. But what does it do to the person? See, because I've had firsthand knowledge with this with someone in my family, mm-hmm. in my extended family, who all her life inside, also I should say that they have the highest suicide rate as well, and that all her life inside felt, and she's a very spiritual person. Of course, she comes from my family. She would automatically be imbued with that. So with her, and with probably all of them, which is why they have such a high suicide rate, they start blaming God. They start thinking, what if the experts have proven that I was born this way, then why? Why would God do this to me? Why would he put me, a girl, inside a male body where I just can't, it's not accepted, it's not, it died, there's just on so many levels, even to them, it doesn't feel right. And I get this firsthand because I've spoken to many of them, and also my own family. So it, when you look at this, it's not benevolent. It's actually very, very sneaky.
It's cruel.
To put in that scientific proof, that medical science has proven that they're born this way. Yeah. So to everybody else, it seems like, oh, it's a benevolent thing. We should be nice. We should be like this, blah, 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 blah. What would Jesus do? You know, except we're not going to do anything that Jesus did because they don't. So I don't even know why they came up with that phrase, what would Jesus do, because they have no clue what Jesus would do.
None at all.
Yeah. And so now all you've done is given these people some authoritative information that God himself has just jammed it in your butt. And
as a figure of speech.
As a figure of speech. I should have said that in this context.
That's okay. You will have double entendre no matter what you do with this. And most gay people that I know have a great sense of humor about it. We're actually speaking to the audience on a level here that I think they'll get this. Mine will.
Well, you know, I'm pretty passionate about this stuff, so, and I get mad easily because I have a very sheepdog personality.
Yeah.
But, you know, everybody thinks that I'm all everlasting agreement, but if I get out of hand, I'm William Wallace, you know? So I have that Gemini thing going on, man, big time. And I have to control the other half quite a bit.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's, you know, it's something that's close to me, and it bothered me for a long time until I believe the Creator showed me this and allowed me to understand that level. I understood it in different nuance, different pieces, but I never understand it fully, and that's why the last chapter of my book is so important, because as far as I'm concerned, as far as I can see, there's no one else on the planet that has given these regendered souls a really good reason, logical and fairly verifiable reason, why they're here that way. Because there's no other reason why they should be here that way. The only other reason is that the Creator is kind of winging it and doesn't actually know what the hell he's doing. And every now and then just kind of gets it wrong. And unfortunately, he's getting it wrong more increasingly as we go. But probably because he's getting older and you have Alzheimer's and different things with age. So maybe that's what it is. So it's either that or it's being done on purpose. And when you look at all the rest of this whole thing, when you stand in the middle of that room and you assimilate all the information and you know it, it's on the tip of your tongue, then you could put it all together like this and you can see that, no, he's not actually an Alzheimer's victim. It's not him at all. It's because we chose to be here, and this is what's going on, which leads right into what we're going to talk about now, which is the NSA surveillance stuff, because we've also chosen that. And we're about to make the third choice, I think. I posit that we're about to make the third choice, which also goes into what a lot of people think is what prophecy is saying, but they've been wrong, as usual. And that third choice will probably be the last choice. And maybe that's why, you know, in those days we're not shortened that no souls will be left. Maybe that's what that was talking about. But the whole NSA thing, what we were talking about, you know, if you remember, was something I've looked at for quite a long time and wasn't making sense of a lot of it. And a lot of it was had to do with their massive data collecting, is what we were talking about. And I had seen a show now a few weeks ago now on RT, which is Russian TV, Russian news.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
RT, which has become pretty popular.
Russia actually, Today, basically. Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't realize that how many major personalities that I've listened to on their own shows through the years that now have their own shows on RT.
Right. Yeah.
Well, one of them, the one I was watching, was, I believe, I didn't even know the guy existed until I saw this. I think it was Jesse Ventura's son has a show on RT. And he had a couple of NSA employees, high-level NSA employees, their former employees. And they were talking about the massive data collecting thing and all that. And what I got while I was watching these guys is... as truful as it seemed they were trying to be, they had gaps in their knowledge, in their understanding. They went through the different data collection that's been happening. They didn't understand. They were saying that the different data collection was incredibly diverse. They said that it was a lot of it now, over the last 5 or 8 years, has started to become very intimate information collecting. Of intimate data, and they didn't understand why. And then they said on top of it all, the bulk collection of it is so large that they said sifting through it now for real-time alleged anti-terror use, which is something I said to my friend years ago. I said if they collected so much information, if that's what they're really doing, then they're never, ever going to be able to sift through it for any useful means. It's you're just not going to be able to sift through it fast enough to stop that terrorist, that real-time stuff, which is what they tell us it's for, right? So that's what these guys were saying. That obviously, that's what they believe it was for. It was for a collection of specific data that would help to, you know, on certain people, not everyone, that would help that they can sift through quickly and, you know, stop the bad guys like superheroes. So. These guys were saying they don't believe that any longer. There's too much information. They said, you know, we know they have the big data collection center in Utah, which is enormous, right? And these guys said that now there's another one being made, built at Fort Meade, which is four times that size as the one in Utah. And they kept saying it doesn't make sense. They don't understand. There's no computer. There's no people that can sift through this stuff. Even if they had computers that could sift through it in real time and make those connections, they don't have enough people that will be able to now sift through that, to take that information and move it along for it to be used in the field, which, you know, anybody with half a brain really thinking about this would come to that same conclusion. I found it interesting how they were going into how much the information was intimate. That they, you know, why do we need information on what people buy on Amazon and on eBay and on, you know, where their houses are, what their houses look like, what cars they drive from the DMV, when their cars change, when they sell a car, they buy a new car, that's updated information in the system. They, you know, this is all stuff I've heard before, and these guys were saying it doesn't make sense to them. That level of detail didn't make sense to them. They don't know what to do with it. Now, maybe they're lying. Maybe they do know. I got the feeling that they really don't know. They seem like good guys. They seem like patriots. They're trying to figure this stuff out. They're, you know, they're risking their butts on TV, I'll tell you that. But I think, you know, I can pretty much sum it up in one short sentence, that this bulk collection, this detailed, intimate bulk collection of data, and when I say detailed, they're saying, and if they're admitting to this even on the smallest level, even these two guys, you can imagine it's much, much deeper than that. So he's talking about what lamp you bought on eBay, what the inside of your house looks like, what the outside of your house looks like, what all the sound of your voice is. This is bulk collection is being used. This is what I'm positing, that this bulk collection. Now, the reason why I'm positing this, let me say this first, like you know, Randy, is that we have Kurzweil, we have Bill Joy, we have major people, scientists, pseudoscientists, corporation owners like Bill Joy of Sun Microsystems and whatnot, where these guys were all on record for many years, I mean since the 70s, like you know, talking about the fact that soon, which soon was back years ago, would be able to not only remove the consciousness, the soul, from the human body and upload it into another reality, another holoverse, okay, that they created, but they're even on record as saying that it has to be done because this holoverse, this creator-created hollow matter-based super hologram was created by the creator but usurped. Okay, so that's the truth of it that we can know. But they always use most of the truth or a lot of the truth to sell their lies. So what they've on record is saying, and I know you probably heard this, I think Kurzweil as well said it, was that they are or have, I think they have, and I think they're populating it now, created somehow, well, by the high technology given to them by the Archons, another place, another so-called reality that they intend to somehow load everyone's soul into in the future. Now, what they've said and why I believe this to be true is because they've gone as far as to say, in writing, that another evil entity created this place to enslave us, and that all they're doing is trying to save us and trying to find a way to kind of get us all to jump into this adjacent creation. Now, that tells me all I need to know, because I know who created this place, how it was created, why it was created. I know enough to know that this is not the fake one, and a lot of that's in my book. But I also know enough to know how it was usurped, why it was usurped, and what's been going on ever since, which is what this whole book's about. And to know that when these whack jobs start telling me that they created another one that they want everyone to go into to save us, that's, you know, right up there with, hi, I'm from the federal government, and I'm here to help you. That's right up there with
it. Yeah, the most dreaded right? words you can hear.
Exactly. So what I'm looking at here, I'm taking all that into consideration, everything that's in my rotunda in that consideration. I'm looking at this. I'm seeing what these guys are saying as I'm watching it, and I'm saying the bulk collection data is intimate and vast because they need that. They need to know what your rug looks like, what your house looks like, what your children look like, what your family looks like. They need to know what everything looks like to be able to copy it, to populate the new false holoverse that they've created. So they're not collecting intelligence to be used for terrorism or anything else. They're collecting consciousness data, not intelligence. So if you break it down and now look at it this way, look at the proliferation of cameras everywhere around the world for facial recognition for really no reason. They really don't need that to stop anybody that they need to stop or do what they need. It's used because the facial recognition software maps your face, it maps your body, it maps all the different, and if you, I just saw something on Walmart during that whole Jade Helm thing. I was doing some research on it, somebody sent me some, and it gave some kind of statistic that 85 or 89% of all Americans have at one time or another, while on the road, whatever, have gone into a Walmart. Now, years ago I noticed this, and I always wondered about it. It never made sense to me why when you pull into a Walmart supercenter, they got like 12 freaking cameras on the outside of the building, on the front. And there's just as many all around the other side. And the inside, people don't notice it, is like camera central. That is probably the most surveilled place. I mean, I bet the Pentagon isn't as surveilled as one Walmart is. And
well, apparently it wasn't on 9/11 because we can't find film of the so-called plane crashing into the side of the damn thing. But
yeah, yeah, the missile. But the cruise missile. But I always wondered that because I'm a very observant person, and I really watch my surroundings, and I found out that not only that, after that the whole Jade Helm thing was going on, and people were freaking out and taking pictures of. I mean, I saw the pictures. They had closed all these Walmarts, and they surrounded them with fencing with barbed wire facing in, and they got pictures of the inside, which was completely emptied out, and they had like, you know, different walls put up that looked like, you know, for ushering people by tables, and it looked like processing, and you know, like kind of like a processing centers for people, and I thought that was really interesting. But while I was looking at that, I found other video or pictures of what I had no idea it could existed, and there's really no reason for it to exist, was that a lot of these super centers around the world, which because they're all over the place, have what looked to me like an underground tactical operations center, literally under the building. And I just couldn't believe what I was seeing. It was actual pictures, people with Walmart, blue Walmart shirts on, sitting at a very large round area, you know, full of computers, and this is underground. And I thought, this is really over the top. What the hell would they need that for? And as you dig further and you dig further and you find out who Sam Wall was during World War II and his connection to concentration camps and working with the OSS at that time and things like that, then the dots start to come together. So
that's another Nazi international operation,
right? And when you see that and see what people don't know is something else I found out through someone else who's in the military I know very well, said that there's a whole nother shopping list that the U.S. government has with Walmart,
mm-hmm.
and this person, this person's in the U.S. Special Forces, and he said that if you are in another country and you need M4s, ammunition, rocket launchers, a tank, doesn't matter, they use their infrastructure to get it to you through their Walmarts. So it's a literal logistical system for military use as well, which completely blew my mind. But it makes sense. They made the biggest system, and of course they're totally subsidized through the U.S. government and always have been.
Well, not only that, but they are being funded on the public side by the profits that they're making there. I mean, they have the ability to operate on a scale that wouldn't be possible, it wouldn't be practical for military operations. But when you go front-facing public and you create an infrastructure for retail centers on that level, you then have not only plausible deniability, but you have multiple streams of income as well that subsidize the underground structure. I mean, this is exactly what post-World War II Nazis have been doing.
Yeah,
they've run all kinds of parallel operations in order to create plausible deniability and also ancillary funding processes.
Right, and exactly where we're going next, because what we're looking at here, so you have this collecting, data collecting, right, from Walmart to everywhere, sitting in your car, doesn't matter, it's collecting the information about your car, it's collecting information, everything, everywhere, especially Europe, is silly with cameras. So if they're using this data collection from all these cameras everywhere, then you have the TSA, right? You have the TSA doing body scans. And don't think for a second, I read a whole other article a few years ago from some expert that built those machines that was saying that they don't just do body scans, that they're actually scanning every detail inside and out of your body and that they have the ability to store it. Oh, well, if they have the ability to store it, then I'm going to just go out there on a limb and say they have been storing it. So if they're now, so you have that avenue. You have total body scans, so your complete physicality, facial recognition from this place. You got the body scanning from that place. You have blood samples being taken by your medical community and by law enforcement community now to fill in the DNA aspect of a lot of it. Of course, then you have all this BS about, findyourheritage.com and send us some of your DNA. I mean, that is just, I won't even get into that, but you have a lot of different levels of where that is filled in as well. And what is all this for? I'm gonna posit that all of that data is now being collected. Why? To fill in the information needed to create your new avatar body on the other side. And so as I'm thinking about this and talking over with others, having conversations, you know, the first question is how are they going to get anybody to do that? I mean, you know, they're just going to come out and say, hey, well, we have this other place, and if you just do this, that, or the other thing, or just walk through this Stargate, or just walk, you know, sit on this table, whatever, you know, take the red pill, take the blue, green pill, whatever. You just take this or do that, and you'll go. Nobody's going to do that. I mean, that's beyond, you know, they won't do that. So that brings me to the next level of how they're going to do that. And I think we can all understand and know this is probably a pretty good idea of how they would do this. Well, how do they do everything? They do it by fear. Everything has been done by fear. From the smallest level to the greatest level, it's all been based on a fear-based system. So that's how they would do it. The only way they're going to get people to consent, living souls to consent to such a thing, would be to somehow, well, have their mechanism in place, which I'm going to posit is CERN, again, from alleged scientists who have come out of CERN, not one but several, saying that it is not at all what they have said it is. It has nothing to do with this matter, that matter, or any matter. It has to do, and there's a, I have to say, I listened to a two-hour interview with the guy, and I do believe he was a scientist. I know enough about science to know when somebody's full of it. And he seemed like he was, and I've heard others as well talk about it or write about it, and they're all saying the same thing, that it that it's not what it appears to be, what they're saying it is, and that it is actually going. And this is what blew my mind and why I believe the first guy I listened to for 2 hours was for real, because there is no reason anybody in their right mind should come out of any science project like that, or even outside of that science project, and just come out of the blue sky with the idea that that machine is being developed to literally remove the souls from all of the people on the earth and transport them to another place. That is exactly what he said. I heard that like 2 years ago. And when I heard that, I thought, you know, he sounds like a scientist. He's very well spoken, great vocabulary. I don't think he pulled that out of his you-know-what. That, because that is not, to me, that is not an obvious thing. I mean, it's an obvious thing to me that at some point, with all the information I have, that I have collected, that there is going to be something somehow that they're going to try, which they've already said, is going to be some kind of technology, Kurzweil and others, they're going to have this ability to remove us from one slave body to another. So I know that that is definitely in their plan, or they probably have it already. So when this guy said that, that it was specifically CERN, I have to give that some credence. I can't dismiss that. So if that's the case, then there's probably at some point they are going to unleash something that is going to create such a level of visceral fear in every human on the planet, some kind of, I can't believe it would be a virus or anything like that. I can't believe it would be a zombie apocalypse. That's not quite enough. I think it would have to be something along the lines of their alien BS. And I think it would have to be done in such a way that it was so overwhelmingly, decidedly, absolute that you were not going to make it. And the only way to do it is to, whatever, put this chip in your right hand or your forehead, like the Christians think. You know, I don't know, put a little Star Trek communicator on your left breast. I don't know. And you'll be instantly magically transported to another place that we, because we knew this was coming. I mean, you know, you could just see the whole Hollywood thing rolling out. But that's how it would have to be. It would have to be such an overwhelming fear that that there would be no thinking left about it. It would be nothing more or less than animal instinct of survival. Just hand it to me. I'll shove it in, you know, up my nose if I have to. Just get me the hell out of here, kind of a thing. And I think that's where they're going with this. And then, you know, so the impetus for everyone to give their consent, all right, to go to a place that they created that they could all live for safely and free and forever and all those good things, would be some kind of alien thing. And where's that? Where's that alien thing going to come from? That's the next question. Well, what's been coming up in the last few years? Antarctica, more and more Antarctica. And then, a week later, my wife, I think, was listening to the Hagman report. And Hagman had on Steve Quayle, who's also from Montana. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, people probably know who Steve Quayle is. And
I know Steve Quayle quite well, thank you. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm gonna keep my opinion to myself.
Yeah, yeah.
He just came out with a new book. And Hagman had him on there. And they were doing an interview like this about his new book. And his new book is right back with the whole third grade Christian level of stuff. And I was actually kind of shocked, even for him, because the book is about these beings in Antarctica, these alien beings who live in Antarctica, and of course he roped in the whole BS Nazi narrative with Antarctica. Now, as soon as somebody does that, I know right off the bat they're either working for that side or they're uninformed. So anybody doing any research on any of that, Admiral Byrd, the whole Antarctica thing in the 50s, the Antarctic Treaty, especially if you do a little research and really, really, really listen to what Byrd said and different things that he said about beings being there and this and that, that very quickly turned into nothing but a I'm going to say a third grade level 1950s cover story of the Nazis taking over Antarctica.
Yeah.
And all that. That is nothing but a cover story, and it's not even a good one. And what, I mean, that's, listen to me. That Nazi BS cover story is right up there with the cover story we just heard a few weeks ago of Buzz Lightyear going.
Going down to Antarctica, yeah. They had to bring him out, and he's screaming that there's something horrible and evil and vile down there. Which goes into this current internet myth of this Ark of Gabriel thing that was unleashed, and apparently the Russians came in and grabbed this thing and convoyed it down to Antarctica where they dropped it. There's no proof for any of this. It's all mythology, and it's all created stories. I mean, this is the web. Let's not forget this.
Yeah, and it's also, you have, it was like, what, 2 weeks after the Mormon traitor, evil Satanist, whatever his name is, Senator Kerry.
Yeah.
Went down there for some alleged
reason. During the election, yeah. Yeah, there's been numerous activity going on down in Antarctica, and it just seems to pop up at convenient times. It's like this giant smokescreen that they keep in the background that they'll just launch every once in a while.
Yeah, and there might be some veracity to some of it. They're for all we know, that's an Archon home base. I mean, we don't know. Because why? Because they've had it off limits since the 50s. So because why? Because, oh, I guess there's Nazis there. But so we have this new book from Quill, and he's talking about Antarctica and the beings that live there and how it's all under Nazi control and all this Nazi crap. And that's really what it is. And then you have, what was his name, the astronaut that went down there and got his ass handed to him. And they came out with an equally ridiculous story of altitude sickness at sea level, which is a good one. I got to say, that's a handy one. I mean, that had to be somebody fresh out of grad school or something that was on their way back with them that they asked to come up with a cover story. And he said, altitude sickness, at sea level. So, that's right up there with Nazis taking over Antarctica. But this is, but again, we don't know for sure what's there. Obviously something's there, but Quayle and others roped this into prophecy that it has to do with Antarctica, has to do with UFOs, has to do with the giants. So right off the bat, you're telling me Nazis took over Antarctica, which I know is BS. You're telling me UFOs exist, which I know is BS. You're telling me, giants exist, which, tell you the truth, I don't care because I have a 50 caliber sniper rifle for that. You're telling me all these things exist, and all it is all more BS narratives. So you obviously must be either stupid or one of the people set to promote it. And why are they set to promote it? Because they need to promote it. You have the leaders of the world going there on continued visits, right? And it's all going to be a mass narrative delusion of death and destruction. And that's what you would have to have. I mean, without that, you're not going to get anyone to agree or move out of this creator-created matter-based hologram into their newly created holoverse. You're not going to. You're going to have to. You need those sheep to be gripped in total fear.
Mm-hmm.
To get anyone to move through that cattle chute. And when I look at all this, that's what I'm coming up with. I mean, it doesn't mean it. Doesn't mean it's true. I'm just saying that's what all the available information says to me. When all these guys are telling you that they have the ability, that they have the technology, you know, to build that $6 million man. Well, I'm guessing that, you know, they're saying it for a reason. Why? Because it all comes back to free will. Like I said, they have to line out that parallel path. They have to tell you. That's why they, for years I've had people asking me, well, why do the elite always telegraph their punches? Why do they always seem to say in a newspaper or an article or on TV or somewhere that they're going to do this and they're going to do that? It doesn't make any sense because it just, you know, makes people aware of it. And I would tell them, well, that's the idea. It's their, they look at it like it's their elitist game of fair play, okay, that it wouldn't be right if we just enslaved these people and never gave them an inkling that what was coming. I mean, we should probably at least lay it out a little bit here and there, lay it out, and, you know, let the smart ones escape the net. Because if they're that smart, they deserve to escape it. And the rest of them, they don't deserve to escape it. They need to be slaves, because they want to be slaves, because they're stupid. So they want to be slaves. And that's how they think of it, but that's not the real truth of it. That's just the below truth of it. The as above truth of it is that it's based on the free will system, like I show in the book, and that you cannot remove the true narrative from the narrative. You can't remove it, because once you completely remove it, make it so that no one can ever find it, no matter how smart they are, then that game ends for them that day. See, they can't usurp free will. They don't have to market it to you. They don't have to add a free will curriculum point to the or a class to the curriculum of public school. Okay, they don't have to do that. They just have to make it available somewhere. It's available. You didn't find it. Not my problem. See? That's how this works. That's why consent is so absolutely key, and why I've been telling people for a long time, stop consenting to virtually everything. Everything. I don't care if you're standing at the DMV and they're asking you to consent to this, consent to that, stop consenting. Stop. You know, just make it part of your personality. Become incredibly anti-consenting, however you want to call it. I'm an anti-consenter, you know, like an anti-dentite.
I'm not only anti-consent, a lot of times I get in their face and go, what right do you even have to demand this information in the first place?
Right.
Because 90% of the time they don't know, they don't care, they're mindless drones. I did this in a hospital. I'm playing there, I'm passing out. I mean, they've just poisoned me with one of their pharma drugs. And they want my social security number. Are you insane? I've been a patient in this hospital before. What right do you have my social security number? Well, we need it for records. I went, well, according to my social security card, that is not for identification purposes. Now, if they've changed this, let me know. But in the meantime, do your job and stop bothering me for trivial data. Because that's all they were doing. It was another form of consent. We want to know what your artificial slave number is so that we know that you consented to be billed ridiculously for things that we're not going to tell you until we hand you the bill, which will exceed your insurance. Because, well, you know, it just goes on and on. We have to be divergent. That's the word. Remember we talked about this on the show that nobody will ever hear because it got nuked. Was this divergent term, which got popularized in a series of movies. But it's a great word to use, because if you're divergent, you're going in the opposite direction of where they want you to go.
Right. Right. Make yourself, like I said, make yourself the opposite of...
I'm a royal pain in the ass to deal with. Anybody that, even my own company knows this. I go to them routinely and throw paperwork at them and go, you know, what the hell is this? Why are we doing this? We need to challenge the system every day, and at least that way we're grinding them down. I mean, if, you know, people forget there's a hell of a lot more of us than there are of them. I don't care how many bureaucrats they have. And furthermore, right, their data collection systems at this point, while they are becoming all-encompassing and ridiculously mired in minutia, I still have to question who in the hell is doing analysis on this. And they're going to go.
Yeah. No, that's what those two guys were saying on the RT show, was that there's nowhere near enough people to ever do the analysis on the data collected, so it's worthless.
Well, what they're saying as a cover story is that they're formulating AI, that they're building quantum computers, which, you know, so far, I know there are people out there on the internet talking about this D-Wave computer and the implementation of quantitative AI. But the fact of the matter is that we can't even define AI right now. We can't define quantum computing. I'm pretty convinced that we have something that probably is what they consider to be quantum level computing, and I believe we've had it for quite a while, and it sits strangely close to that Fort Meade location down in Maryland. I know because I've been there. But we're not at the point where we can analyze data on a granular level to make the kind of data aggregation that they're doing right now useful. Most of this is just sloughed off, and they're sifting for the big hits. But like I said, I don't.
Go ahead.
Exactly. This is where we just want to go right into the nugget. I mean, let's just push this out there. They're building something else. They're building the next level to this matrix.
Right. Well, I mean, they've said they are. So I mean, we don't have to guess. You know, that's the beauty part of it. We don't have to guess. I mean, they said it. There's an evil entity has enslaved us in this one, so we made another one. We're making another one that we're going to move to and save everybody. I mean, they said it, so I'm not guessing. I mean, they had to say it. They have to say it. They have to lay the groundwork ahead of time. They have to lay it out ahead of time. They have to lay that parallel path out. And the meek shall inherit the earth. So who's the meek? Not the weak ones. The ones who don't do it. The ones who say, I'm not scared of whatever the hell I'm seeing here. Just like the prophets have said, you know, don't leave your house in those days. Don't this and that, the other thing. All the things I wrote about in like my Greater Exodus book. Lay it out very clearly of what the prophets actually said, the real prophets, and what they actually said, not what people say they said they said. So when you look at that, well, that's all they're doing. They're telegraphing their punch. They're laying it out because they have to, because of free will. You have to give people the choice. It has to be there. Choice has to be somewhere. It has to be somewhere. And so this time, it's not going to be a choice. I'm just putting it out there. It doesn't mean I'm right. I'm just saying that I believe this time it won't be a choice that you're going to have to find. You're not going to have to be a scholar. You're not going to have to be anything. It's going to be a choice, just like it was the first time, that you're going to have to consent to. That's why in the book I show, in the beginning, the separation of souls above and souls below. Because some consented and some didn't. The ones that didn't have to stay here. The ones that did have to stay here. And here we are. So this is just going to be like that. No one's going to have to find this information. No one's going to have to be a scholar, you know, or an expert of any kind. They're just going to have to say no. Will they be killed for it? Yeah, I don't know. I mean, there's other prophecies that say that. The Greater Exodus prophecy that I've proven beyond a shadow of a doubt is, and also I've proven it to be the only prophecy that's complete. It's the only one that you can verify from stem to stern, up and down, right and left, and none of the other ones you could do that with. All the other ones are fragmented and half understood. At best, half understood. So with that prophecy, it's very important because that one shows that, guess what? No, you don't have to be killed during that time, physically killed. Not that I think it matters if you are. It doesn't matter because you can't kill us. He can put you right back here in your soul body if he wants to or whatever. It doesn't matter. So whatever happens at that point, we're going to consent to or not consent to. Whatever happens after we consent or not consent, that doesn't really matter either. But, you know, it's going to be exciting. I hope I'm around for it. You know. But
yeah, I kind of suspect we're here for that particular event because I don't think we're that far off. And I think they got to pull the trigger soon on this thing because, again, the 2012 scenario, going back to that and the wave that has gone on, since the 60s and then again in the 80s, we just have had successive waves of waking up. And this is the waking up of real souls, not the artifices that are seeded into the earth realm. I mean, you and I have talked about this as well, that the population numbers don't make sense. How in the hell did we double population in less than 30 years on this planet, given the genocide in Africa, the genocide in China, the dwindling, if not plummeting, birth rates in Western Europe and the United States? How do you go from 3 billion people to nearly 7 billion people in less than 30 years? If you run probability tables, like, you know, considering that we might multiply like rabbits, it barely makes sense at all. So the question becomes, first off, I don't think there's 7 billion people on the planet, and secondly, I'm challenging that even some of what's here may not be human. And I know that that's a ridiculous, absurd claim, but I'm basing it somewhat on my own spiritual discernment of things that I've seen and know about, and also on the fact that on the prima facie evidence that I don't think most of the information that they've given us about who we are, what we are, and where we are makes any damn sense at all.
No, well, number one, right off the bat, everything. Like I said about Hiroshima and Nagasaki, right? Shouldn't anyone that hears me say that go, oh, my God, he's right. Everything I've ever heard about, you know, nuclear bombs and radiation, 1,000 to 10,000 years, that land and everything will be completely barren and useless and radioactive. But how are those people there, and how is it normal, and how is it documented that plants and grass were growing, you know, 3-4 months later over there out of that rubble and everything? So, see, nobody thinks of these things, but that's what they rely on, that very few. But again, you know, you did say that to me about a certain amount of, or maybe even a majority of people.
Well, that's a very disturbing concept when you think about it.
It is very disturbing, and I have to say, I thought about it after you said it, and it reminded me of my friend here, a very smart guy, and from years ago when I was teaching him all this stuff and things and showing him what was fake and what was real and all this stuff, he gravitated toward it immediately because he, in his own spirit, in his own soul, knew it from a young age, he said. He knew that all the religion in his family was teaching was all lies. It wasn't real. It couldn't be this. It couldn't be that. It didn't make sense. So he was always questioning. And so when I would show him things in black and white and show him what it said really and what it didn't say and this and that, and he would come back and say, you know, a couple of weeks ago, I was talking to my next-door neighbor who's a doctor. He's got a PhD, blah, 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 and all this stuff. He goes, and I was explaining to him what you explained to me, and I showed him in black and white. And no matter what I said, and no matter how I showed him in black and white that it didn't exist, he rebelled against it and would not see it, said he couldn't understand it, mm-hmm. didn't make any sense, mm-hmm. and this and that. And then over the years, he would come back to me and said, another one, and another one, and another one. And he would say, I don't understand how these seemingly highly, now he's a doctor in a medical profession and everything, so he that's his circles. So he's saying, look, I know these people, they're smart, they're this and that. Why don't they see it? I don't understand how they cannot see it. It's right there. And, you know, I never had an answer for him. I just said, you know, it's just, it's not their time. It's their soul is not ready to see it. But then when you said what you said, I thought, you know, I heard somebody else not too long ago, somebody sent me somebody's website, and they were going on about how a majority of what we think are humans on this planet do not have souls. And I was like,
I grappled with this for a long time. It is the most disturbing thing, because all of a sudden you're placed in a position of, who got to decide that? How do I discern this? It's troublesome. I mean, it's, you know, the burden of knowledge is knowing something and then having to carry that forward. It is...
Right. Right. So really, see, my position was, when I heard this woman going on, it wasn't only her, then it was another one and another one and another one, I was like, why? Why do all these people think there's so many human bags of water walking around without souls? You know, why did they think that? I couldn't find out. I didn't stay in it long enough because I'm too busy. So I didn't stay in it long enough on that particular genre to find out why they believe what they believe, because that's important to me. But, you know, because I stand at the point where I'm thinking, well, all right, so a physical being cannot be animated without a soul. It's the soul that animates the body. Even medical science proves that. Or else, if that wasn't true, then we wouldn't need life support. You wouldn't need life support. Life support is only there for when the soul is not attached any longer. When the soul is there, as soon as Eben Alexander came back, boom, he was off life support, and his body was miraculously healed very quickly. Same as my friend Michelle, who took, 20 tabs of acid back in the 60s and died. And then, boom, as soon as her soul came back, she woke up right there with the EMTs and all her friends, sat up, looked around, said, what the hell's the matter with everybody? She didn't even know that she took the acid. She was completely physically fine when she woke up, you know, 15 minutes later. So... without a soul, I don't understand, you know, how these alleged bodies are walking around. Maybe they have a partial soul. I don't know. But I think you might be honest on, because, like I said, there is a lot of people that just, well, no matter
what. And I didn't want to muddy the waters too much with that particular theory in this context. We just kind of went there. So, you know, I'll drop that out. That is something I'm going to elaborate more on in some platform, some way. It's kind of been oozing out over the edges on the off-planet radio and TV shows for quite a while. And I do have reasons why I believe that's true, and I also have theories that go into a little bit more complexity relating to souls and dimensional aspects that may make this possible. But let's not forget that one of the goals of black science has been reanimation. And it's not lost on me that this all plays into something that's a larger scale plan that I think they're working on. Look, if they're creating another artificial reality, an upload, another staging process to upload souls. And I mean, these things go back to the 90s. I was on a Usenet group on the internet in the 90s called the Extropians, that were basically a group talking then about biological immortality. This is actually where you began to get the memes that spun off into Ray Kurzweil's stuff later on. In fact, Kurzweil was on these forums back in the 90s. So they've been poking around the surface of this for a long time. I mean, the rumors have been rife out there about all kinds of enabling mechanisms to somehow biologically preserve enough material to make what we might call soul transplantation viable. I mean, Disney had his head cut off and frozen, a cryogenics project, after he died. There's been numerous projects around preservation of biological material with an eye on biological immortality. But they may just forego the biological completely, and then you get into all of these constructs that we've had in cyber reality, which is Second Life, Oculus Rift, Google Glass. I mean, Facebook bought Oculus Rift, and they've not yet fully released exactly what they plan to do with it. But like Google, you know, they're a testing laboratory for a lot of other things that we've been woven into the fabric. I have to think that the immersion technologies are what they're looking at now is basically cyber, virtual servers, virtual reality worlds, again, taking data extrapolated from all of this data harvesting, creating virtual worlds where, you know, consciousness-wise, and, you know, we have to talk about consciousness and talk about the soul, too. Consciousness-wise, projection into one of these, well, we'll just call it a black cube, for lack of a better word. And basically, your soul is absorbed into that. It's cut off. You still have a soul. And remember, that's another thing about this as well. I mean, you may have a soul, but that soul may be cut off from source, as, you know, we've talked about in many of these shows. So I'm kind of speculating at this from a very wide parameter that isn't governed by a lot of scholarship, fortunately. I don't have to go and prove my work to anybody. That's the beauty of being a raconteur. So, just saying.
No, that's exactly right. That's exactly where I think it's going, because they've said it. They've said it. So obviously you can't destroy the soul because it's energy. So, and it was created, it's a part of an eternal creation, so it's eternal. It can't be destroyed by us or any other creation that was created by that same original creator. So,
but, you know, what happens at the point where so many, I mean, look, you know, all people got to do is look at the logo we created for this series, the TriUnity series, the Tian symbol, the Chinese symbol. That was that symbol, which is in your book, exhibits the partition between what you call heaven and the lower realms. So we know that what sits above that is creator, it's source, it's the eternal one. What sits below it at various levels of compartmentalization are souls, they're living souls, they're part of the original creation, but they are presently partitioned or cut off, or in some sort of state of exile, away from access to source. So there's all kinds of levels to that. And then they create another level. Now we create a cyber level, and we containerize souls into a synthetic realm where they now have no access to biological capabilities, no access to earth energies. Are we not at that point vacuumizing, I just made that up, vacuumizing the human soul into a container from which theoretically it may not be able to escape? And have not we created then at that point, which is basically a death chamber of the soul, where it simply exists in a looping reality forever?
Yeah, and that's what they say, that you'll be able to live forever there, away from this evil entity, blah, 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 blah. And I find that interesting. Although I know it is the evil entity who's creating it in the first place, and then having them market it as an escape from him, it. So, I mean, you know, you'd have to be a real dumbass not to figure that out. But no one's going to get a chance to figure that out, because they're just going to be presented with something so horrific and a very quick escape route that, you know, they're just going to start running towards the door. And they're not going to even think about what's on the other side. They're going to consent to taking that escape the same way we consented in the first time, whenever that was, however that was. We consented to it without knowing the fine details. you know, the fine print, like I say in the book, and here we are. So now is the next step. Now, since the Creator still has a way out for us here, I think they think that they're going to be able to trump that somehow by somehow creating some alternate reality, whether it's technological, it would have to be technologically based. It could be a technology that none of us could even conceive of yet, but that, you know, to us, the monkeys, it looks like magic, but it doesn't mean it's not technology. So they might have this technology. It might not even be here. It might be literally in an adjacent reality.
I think it's here. I think it's here. And I think it's been here for a long time, and I think the implementation of it was delayed.
I don't think it could be here, because if it's here, then the Creator would still have access to it. Not that he wouldn't have access to it anywhere. I don't think you can go anywhere where he doesn't have access, because everything that exists.
I don't think it works.
In with. So I know it's like this crazy looping BS.
Yeah, that's part of the loop. But their technology didn't work in the past, and it doesn't work now. The deception here is to... I'll tell you what the real deception is, in my opinion. It is to keep us forever glued to trying to plumb mysteries that are unnecessary. We are just constantly trying to thread a needle here when truth is simple.
Yes, yes. I. Oh, my God, man. I'm so glad you said that, because that is something I said a few months ago, maybe a month or two ago, to a lot of people. I sent thousands of emails out right before my laptop crashed and lost thousands of emails. But that is what I said, because I was getting a lot of input back from people from stuff that just saying, you know, I'm looking at this, I'm looking at this, I'm, you know, what do you think about this? And, you know, this guy says this, and that guy says that, and this, and the other thing. It's hard for me to...
You get it, I get it. This is what we get all the time. And I have to tell you that my fatigue level with this, after 7 years of doing this show and 7 years doing the previous show, has largely become, you know what? If you've done this much research, when in the hell are you going to take your research and sit down and actually think about what you've learned and what you didn't learn? Because at some point... You know, this is why I've closed all of these shows saying the truth is out there, it's inside you. I'm trying to tell people, at some point, you can't prove this anymore. You have to know it. This has to be something that you draw out of your own beingness. If you are connected to Source, then for God's sake, go to Source with this.
Right.
You know, we've researched ourselves to death in this culture.
And all it does is keep leading you down ridiculous other paths that take you further from the truth. And I know that people, and it's very difficult for me to say this and to start in on this conversation with individuals or a bunch of people, because, you know, I've watched since I was young teaching this stuff, more and more teaching this stuff, mostly to Christians that were really messed up, or, you know, recovering Christians, as I call them. I saw that, you know, that they were so lied to for so long, and then they would go to the next guy, and then 2 years there, 3 years there, boom, they find out they're being lied to. Next guy, 3 years there, they find, I mean, shit, 15, 20 years later, they're beat up, and they're like, you know, and so here I am, and I tell them, look, this is it. This is all there is. There's only one sin.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
One sin, and that is the sin of not returning to that which you have left, which you have consented to leaving. I'm showing you how to return. I'm showing you how simple it is. I'm showing it from your own books that you believe are true. And the ones that it's in them, boom, they get it. And that's like, and I got to say, it's the percentage is even blown my mind, for especially in the last 10, 12 years, the percentage of people that just read that first book and got it. They would call me up, they would email, they would say, oh my God, this is exactly what I knew it had to be, but I didn't have the information, I didn't have the language, the scholarship, the culture, I didn't have what I needed to understand that I was right, or to prove to anybody else that I was right, but then they got it. So it's because their time was right. Their field was cultivated, and it was ready to receive that, like Jesus would say, that seed. Okay, so that is, I got to say, the 99%. I mean, I've had incredible results that even I could not believe. I figured I did not want to put out that first book. I did not want to put it out. I fought putting it out for a year, and I had to do it, and I didn't want to do it because I thought, man, I am going to be pummeled. And you know what? I just don't need it. I know the truth, and I'll be honest with you, I didn't care if anybody else knew it. I had gone a lot of years trying to teach it and people rejecting it and people telling me, oh, you're the Antichrist. I mean, there's a guy out there right now. I couldn't believe it. My friend Dr. Wong said it to me. He's like, you got to listen to this idiot. And it was some video, and this guy was saying, you know, another Christian doesn't know the language. He's saying, oh, well, this is what Daniel says, and this is that, and Revelation says this, da, da, da. And it goes through, and it says that the Antichrist's name is Asher.
Yeah, I know. I've actually heard that, and I've heard it in reference to this series of shows. Yes, so I've heard
I'm going to say it straight out. Holy shit.
Yeah, or WTF.
And when I look at that and what he was talking about, I have told people, I don't know how many times, the Hebrew book of Daniel does not, even in the remotest way, say what your English says it says.
Nope.
It's not hardly even close.
No.
The ridiculousness is, it's beyond to me. It's epic.
Well, and then they go and buy a Strong's Concordance, and they try to use that, which Gildy did that for many years, found out, completely corrupted, so there you go.
Hello, who do you think gave you the explanation, the minimal and ridiculous explanations of those Hebrew words?
Yeah. You know, Strong's Concordance.
Where do people think that came from? I'm going to go out on a limb and say it came from the same guys who gave you the first Greek translation of the already completely redacted
Hebrew
in Alexandria, Egypt. I'm going to go there, okay? So that's these people are so clueless, it's beyond. And I get people sending me this stuff like, oh, look at this, look at that. And I say, just stop. Just stop. You've already been shown. You've already been shown how not to destroy. You've already been shown, you know, I said that somebody, I think I didn't have to. I read the thing, I guess I sent it to a bunch of people. I showed it to him. I said, look what this idiot's saying. This is like beyond. And some woman that I've been teaching, I mean, since she's the probably 80, 81, great woman. She's from the Middle East. She was Muslim originally. Went to Judaism after that, and then met me, and she got on there and basically read the Riot Act, and you know, told me he didn't know what the hell he was talking about. But she made a good point, because in that video, this guy's Yahweh this, Yahweh that, Yahweh this, Yahweh that, da 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 da, and she made a good point, and I know why she made it, because I've said it a million times. Why are you listening to a guy, an alleged expert, who has not yet even been led to or found on his own the name of the Creator given to Moshe? How can you spend your life in that book and say you're an expert and you've never even known that? You don't even know what that Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh BS is. You don't know who he is. You don't know who instituted that Tetragrammaton. You don't know any of that, but you're an expert on who the Antichrist is, or this or that. And she hit that nail right on the head. I'm glad she did, because, you know, and that's what I tell people. Look, you stop looking at all this stuff. And it's hard for me to say that because I don't want to come off like Benny Hinn. I don't want to come off like somebody, because these people are shell-shocked.
Well, no, this is deep. Look, these people were deeply programmed, and some of them have been programmed inside of the church since they were children. And right. unfortunately, deprogramming them is not for the weak of heart, because they will fight you. They will tear you apart when you begin to dissemble their system. And I know I did it. I suffered the ravages of Christians who, when I finally said, you know, I've looked at this Yahweh God, he's not a good guy. And he's not the father of, he's not the creator God. There's something else going on here. At that time, I knew very little, but I knew that. Well, I took a radio show and group on the internet that had 3,000 people, and just watched it fall apart to where people were just like, Randy Maugans is going to the dark side. He's satanic. He's possessed. Don't listen. You know, that's what they do. And going back to the kind of the, you know, the whole summary of this thing again, you know, I don't want to do this forever. You don't want to do this forever. We have lives. This is simpler than people have made it out to be. It's not easy, and it's not as concise as I'd like it to be and you'd like it to be, but it is relatively simple. Go and do that which you are supposed to do and cease doing that which is evil.
Right. It's pretty simple. That's, you know, I try to tell people that when they come back to me with this stuff, and without sounding like a know-it-all, without sounding like, you know, your Benny Hinn's and your Christian preachers, that I have the truth and I have the only truth, whether I believe that or not, you know, and I know where mine came from. I know that you can't go back any further and find another truth. I absolutely know that, which is why I have no Christian preachers and no rabbis coming after me publicly, because if they open that door with me publicly, they'll be ruined. Especially rabbis, because they don't want to open that door, because they figure, you know what, he'll say it, he'll write a book, it'll blah blah blah, it'll go away, and all the Gentiles are so stupid they're going to forget, you know, and that might be true.
And it's good money too, by the way. It's for profit.
Of course, it's all for profit. I mean, I sure didn't do it for profit. So, you know, my stuff is out there. I was given to do a certain thing. To reiterate a certain truth, because the truth has to be available for free will. And it wasn't available. It hasn't been available. And I don't care what anybody says. You can go search the internet. Before I started teaching this stuff in the early 80s about the name and about the greater Exodus and things like that, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, I coined the greater Exodus.
Yes, you did.
And then later, as I knew it would happen, other Christian and these messianic guys, they saw that, they jumped on it, they started using it here and there, only a couple, really. And then, you know, they Christianized the hell out of the message, and they completely redacted all the truth and came out with their own books and, you know, made a lot of money. But the people who were supposed to, the souls that were supposed to hear, the everlasting agreement, who was supposed to be available to, have received it and are still receiving it in greater numbers, hopefully. I don't see that, but that could be happening. I don't have to know about it. It doesn't mean I know everyone who's reading my book or passing it on or whatever, and that's all it's supposed to be. But, you know, that is the only way back. I don't care what anybody else says or thinks they know. They will not find a more ancient, more original truth than what Isaiah said is the everlasting agreement. They won't. And what Noah spoke about. And they won't find it. And I proved it in that book. So if that's it, if that's the way back, which I have proven it is, and I will stand on that, that it is absolutely, I have proven that. And I don't say that very often. I leave room for being wrong. I'm not. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I'm not the kind of person that, you know, I think I know everything there is to know. But the bottom line is that the things I do know, I know fully and completely, and that is the only way back, and that is the only sin. There is no other sin. And if I've shown that to someone, What I don't understand, like you're saying, is why they continue to search further and further and further when it's just been simplified to the point of, you know, a gnat's brain simplification. It's simple. Just stop and go back. Turn 180 degrees and start walking back to the creator.
The literal, exactly. literal meaning of repentance, by the way.
Yeah, just start going back and do it this way. Just like Eben Alexander was told, the only reason for your existence is love and mercy. Well, if you were only told that, which, by the way, you were told that, he was this guy named Yeshua. He told you that. That's exactly what he told you. It's just that, you know, the other guys got in between and lied all about it and changed the word, changed the meanings of certain things, and it got a little skewed, and now nobody knows what the hell he was talking about, nor do they care, really. But if you just do that, if you just start today, right, and you start making conscious effort to projecting to everything, to every word, to every touch, to every look, everything about your being based on love and mercy, to everything, to every other being that exists, then the only thing that can come out of that is the everlasting agreement. That's it. There's nothing else that can come out of that.
Yeah.
So it isn't like you really have to learn anything. You just have to live that existence and stop everything else, which also means stop looking. Stop looking. You're wasting your time. But it's hard for me to say this to people, you know, because I get self-conscious, because I feel like, you know what, you sound just like this guy. You sound like that guy. You're the only one who knows the truth. Well, what if I am? The last guy who allegedly knew all the truth allegedly got nailed to a cross. And the guy before him, you know, whoever, whether it was Moses, Abraham.
Well, they stoned him or did something. I mean, the body count's pretty high on prophets, the real ones.
Body count's pretty high. So, you know, like I said to people, look, if you don't believe the everlasting agreement is the correct way, or whatever, I said the only way to fight against it is to be a sociopath. Because if you fight against it and tell me that I'm wrong and tell me it can't be, you know, I can eat meat, I can do this, I can go hunting, I can blah, 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 blah. Yeah, okay. Your argument is that you're a freaking sociopath. That's your argument. Because there is no other argument against it. There is no other way. There's no other righteous path. There isn't. You can look all you want. You can say, oh, well, I said these special words about Jesus, so now I'm righteous forever, you know, past the amber. It's not. It, you know, but they keep looking and they keep inundating themselves with what this guy said, all that guy said about the Antichrist, and who cares? None of that matters. I mean, if you truly live your life around this, that all dissolves away. You don't even think about it anymore.
No.
And you shouldn't. And you know what? Tell you the truth, you shouldn't be taking that stuff. You shouldn't be intaking that negativity, because that's all it is. It's additional negativity that eats on, and you know, feeds into your soul that shouldn't be fed into. So really, people should do as much as they can to separate themselves from all manner of that negativity, because see, that is other people not living up to what Eben Alexander and my friend Michelle and many others who died and went back to the Creator were told. That is not those people, whether they're through movies, whether they're through videos, whether it's some idiot telling you the Ash or the Antichrist. These people are not perpetrating. They are not propagating love and mercy. They're not. They're propagating, you know, just negativity. And I think in its essence, it's evil. So I just had this conversation with somebody who sent me something about, I won't go into details, but he's a very super smart guy. I've seen a lot of things that he's talked about and whatnot, and he sends me things and sends them to a lot of people. And it's always this negative stuff. It's about, you know, the Jews this, the Jews that, or, you know, now it's the Hebrews don't exist. They never existed. They were never, it was never this. They were this one. They were that ones. They were over here. They were over there. This book was not that. This didn't exist. That didn't exist. Okay. What are you doing? See, that's all I asked him, because he's a really smart guy. And if you would just turn all that bullshit off, and he would just say, okay, I understand what the everlasting agreement is. It's very simple. It's very straightforward. It's 100% righteous. I should live it, and I should perpetuate it with every word, with every deed going forward. And then I will be emulating, I will be reflecting the Creator for the first time in my life. For the first time in possibly many lives.
Hmm.
That's what we're meant to do. We're meant to return, and returning means reflecting the Creator, because if you're not reflecting the Creator, then you're reflecting the evil ones and all their assimilated BS, see? So that's what I was saying to him. Who's more wise? Is it more wise to get into all these different subjects and prove to people that everything they've ever known or ever believed was 100% fake? Is that wise? Because I told him, I said, you know, you're a really smart guy. I can tell you're smart. Intelligent, good researcher. So am I. And I told him, I said, listen, do you really think that I couldn't have spent my time with my cultural background, with my linguistic background, with my ability, everything I know, do you think I could not have spent my life teaching that every single thing that everyone has ever learned on multiple subjects, but especially the religious end of it, you think I couldn't have done that and taught them that everything was fake, that everything has been a lie, completely 100% verified lie, everything? I told them I could do that in ways today that you haven't even thought of yet. Okay? I didn't. I chose to use the information that these people believe to be absolutely true, show them some of the ways that it's been manipulated, but only the ways, and my attempts were all geared towards one path, to show them the true path, how this was fake and that was fake, and this was slightly augmented and that was slightly augmented, and this is who did it, and here's the proof of it, so that you know I'm not lying. You can go look it up yourself, blah, 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 blah. But here's what they were hiding, and here's why they were hiding it, because it's your way back. And then everything that comes out of my mouth, out of my soul, to these people is geared around how to return. That's it. I have no other thing that comes out of me except for that, pretty much. All the other stuff we talk about is just extraneous BS, but it all comes back to that. It might be truthful stuff about NSA and this and that, but it all comes back to that and why they're trying to do these things, because that exists. And they can't afford everyone or the majority, however that many may be. We don't even know how many that may be, like you're saying. We don't know how many souls are actually here compared to how many people are actually here. Shit, I might have hit them all. I don't know. But, or even half of them. But they can't afford to lose a quarter of them or half of them. So everything they do is geared around subterfuge, and everything I've done was to show just enough subterfuge to be able to prove that I know what I'm talking about and that this is a truthful path back, and no one's ever showed you this. And I'm giving you the ability to prove me right. I'm giving you enough information on both sides so that you can go back and say, I'm going to check this guy out. And you know what? Every single one of them has come back. Not every single one, but most of them come back and say, you know what? I have checked out everything you said, and actually, you didn't even give most of it. They would say, you didn't even give most of it. There's a lot more proving that you're right. I said, of course I didn't give most of it. The book would have been 4,000 pages.
So the summary to this is, do you want to chase 10,000 lies, or do you want to find one truth?
It's right.
Really, comes down to that.
That's the problem, is that, like you said, they've been in a cult for so long that the simplicity of this truth is too hard, because they're so used to ritual on top of ritual and this and that, that this simplicity of this truth is, it's almost devastating. It's like, it can't be just that. I've even had them say that to me. What do we do, like, on Passover? What do we do? All right, you got the four days of the year that are the Creator's days, blah, 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 and how I've showed it through the different texts. And, you know, what do we do on those days? You know, how do we ritualize those days? How do we do that? And you know, I would have to go back with a whole nother paper and show them, look, you're not ritualizing anything. It says very specifically, it's a renewal memorial. And what that means is that you are just treating that as a day to outwardly, which you should do every day anyway, to show the Creator that you're still with Him, that you're still on the right path. And maybe He did that, created that to be 4 days in a year, because most people need the reminder. I don't. I don't need a holiday to do it. I live it every single moment. I'm awake or asleep. I'm sure of it, because I even dream about this stuff. So I don't need that, but I do know a lot of people do need some ritual. And if I know that, He knows that. So that's why those are there, and for no other reason. But I would always get these questions on how to ritualize them. How do we do this? Do we light candles? Do we, you know, hop around on one foot? Do we, you know, twist the chicken in the air? You know, and all these different, you know. And I would have to, you know, back them away. I have to back them away from the cliff. No, it's very simple, and it's actually quite beautiful if you think about it. I would tell them, because look, if say you're Italian, you know, whatever, and you're living in Brooklyn, and you have your culture, right? And so now you're living the everlasting agreement, and you could bring that culture that you've lived in to that, so that those 4 days of the year, when you have your renewal memorials, if you want to treat them like a Passover or whatever, you can say your own prayers, you can make stuff up, you could have your own food the way you want. And if you live like a woman, for people I know in South Africa, I said, now obviously they have a different culture and a different food and different, and theirs is going to be different. I said, so now imagine this. Imagine the day when the everlasting agreement happens. The greater exodus happens, and we're all pulled into camps. However that's going to happen, all right, and we're all pulled in together, and this and that, and now we have what? We have a multitude of cultures who have all kept the same renewal memorials in slightly different ways based on their culture. I said, now look at that. Look at how awesome that would be to learn and to integrate all these different cultures into one now at that point, which would be incredible. So instead of making such a big deal of this and over-spiritualizing, super-spiritualizing, over-ritualizing, and continuing sliding back into these super-spiritualized and over-ritualized ways, simplify. Simplify everything. And I don't care if you go in your backyard, you get on your knees, and you pray that day, renewing somehow yourself to the Creator, that you're still, you know, on that path, and that's all you do. I don't care. Doesn't matter. I'm not the guy making up the rules. There's no rules that I can find that are laid out for that. Therefore, I'm not going to make them up, because I didn't create a new religion. And I'm very quick to say that, because I don't want them to create a new religion, because this is not a religion. It's a path back. That's all it is. So they need to stop going out, like you're saying, looking for the 10,000 lies, all the minutia of stuff that's never going to edify anyone. Because teaching someone that this never existed, or the Hebrews never existed, or that guy never existed, or Moshe never existed, or Jesus never, and there's all that, Jesus never existed, oh, it doesn't, who is that helping? All you're going to do is create people who believe nothing now. And that is only going to create people who are depressed, who are have nothing to hold on to. You're surely, none of that, as smart as you may be, as intelligent as you may be, as great a researcher you may be, and even though I know this person or that person is going after these things because they're looking for truth. Just like I don't care if it's flat earth or whatever it is, they're looking for truth. They're driven, their souls are driven to look for truth. Why? Because they forgot who they are, and they've been made to forget who the Creator is, and they've been made to not be able to feel that connection anymore. See, so their souls are inherently searching, but it's like shotgun effect. They don't know what they're searching for, really. They just know that they have to search, so they start finding this. Oh, this never existed, and that never existed. The Bible's fake, and this is fake, and that's fake, you know, and all of a sudden they're an expert that Jesus didn't exist, or the Bible didn't exist, or the Hebrews didn't exist, and they're an expert, and they gravitate towards that expert. They know everything there is about it, and they're teaching everybody. Who is that edifying except for yourself? It's edifying no one. It's ego.
Exactly.
It's not going anywhere. As much as you're doing it from your heart, that you feel possessed, that you need to research this stuff to show people that this is fake and that is fake, that's important, but it's not wisdom. Knowledge is not wisdom, and one without the other is useless. So that's what I was telling this particular person this time, although I've said this many times to many different people who have always been on the same track, whether it's the people against the Jews, against Jesus, against whoever. Moses didn't exist. This one didn't exist. That, I don't care. It doesn't matter. All I need to know is how to get the hell back. That's all I need to know. And that's where, and if these people who are so smart would just grab this, what I've shown them, not all the peripheral stuff, just the everlasting agreement, and just live that and taught that and only that, we would be moving ahead so much faster, because I can't do it all. I can't be the only force. I had to do the books to get more people out there to drive it forward. I can't be the only one. So that's the idea, to get more people to do it, to move it faster. And so the whole thing grows exponentially, but not when you have these really smart people whose hearts are in the right places for truth, but they've been thrown on the wrong path. But it's not wise. It's just not wise, because it's not edifying the Creator. It's not edifying the people. It's not edifying the people you're teaching it to, because all they're doing is seeing more lies. And it's like the gay person who you've just told, oh, well, God did this to you. You know, you were born this way. Well, oh, isn't that good that I told you this? Because now everybody can know that God did it, it's not your fault. It's not your fault for being like this. And, you know, the gay person kind of smiles and says, oh, well, that's good. That's good. Science says that's good. And they walk away, and they want to jump off of, they want to jump off a freaking a bridge, you know, after that. Because that's not what they need to hear. That's not edifying to them. Because you only gave them a small portion of information that they don't know what to do with. See? So that's what you're doing. That's what these people are doing with other stuff. Whether this one's not true, that one's not true, this, you know, all this other stuff. They're saying, this one never existed, that one never existed, you know, whether it's true or not. You know, because most of it's only half true anyway. So they're teaching people this, and they're only teaching them that. But they're not giving them additional information to know what to do with it, or how to assimilate, or how to understand it, or how to feel about it. See, and so it's like jamming them full of all this stuff, and then just walking away going, oh, you know, now you get to carry it. It's like, dude, what'd you do? Why'd you do that? It didn't help that person. It hurt that person. It's going to make that person carry 10 times more weight than they needed to carry, and then they're never going to be able to see over the pile you just put in their arms to see the everlasting agreement when I show up with it. See? So that's what I was saying. That it's not always wise. Just because you have a lot of knowledge, it's not always wise to you know, just like my grandfather used to say, right? Just because you can doesn't mean you should.
That's right. That's right. I think this is a good place to leave it for this time. We have 2 hours and 30 minutes, and we've dumped a lot of things on the people, and I think you summarized it real nicely along with your heart for how this is all supposed to go. Once again, the book is called Soul Revolution. It's available from Dr. Asher. The links are with the audio, the video, on the YouTube, the webpage, wherever you find it. The website link is there as well for the Ancient Hebrew Learning Center. And we thank you for coming on again today, Shmuel. We look forward to the next installment very soon.
Hey, Randy, let me say one thing real quick.
Sure.
Like I told you, my hard drive crashed in my laptop, and I was using Outlook. And I did have a CSV file with tons of emails on it, you know, kind of, so just in case that ever happened, I lost them. But a lot of new people have come in over the last year, and I didn't make a new file. So when that crashed, I've lost, you know, probably about 35% of all the new people that have been emailing me. So anyone listening to this, go to the ASOC Global blog site that Randy was just talking about, and I have my email there, and start emailing me through that email so that I get your emails again, and I will save them correctly this time. Mm-hmm. So I just want to let everyone...
Yeah, we all learn from painful errors. Okay, that's going to wrap it up for this time. This is the TriUnity Series with Shmuel Asher. I'm Randy Maugans. The truth is out there. It's inside you, and it's so much simpler than you think. Goodbye.